Welcome back, everyone. I'm Mohit Vamsi, and I work as a UX designer at Huge Designs. Most of the world today is trying to figure out the nuances of working from home or working remotely. And it leads many of us to wonder, what about UX? Can this be done remotely? Well, 100% remote UX is doable, and this is going to be the new norm. Since the past week, we have shared our thoughts, opinions of our leaders, and a lot of information through our social media pages. We have also published two blogs on breaking the myths about remote UX and remote UX or success story. Do visit our website and Medium account to go through these interesting reads. Today, I have with me Samir and Prasadd in this Q&A session, and the topic is the secret to successful remote UX. Samir is the founder and CEO of Huge Designs. He's an anchoring support and a visionary leader who leads by example. With over 25 years of experience in setting up UX practices, managing multidisciplinary global teams, and also conducting training programs in usability engineering. And Prasadd is the co-founder and chief of design and research at Huge Designs, with an overall experience of 20 plus years in user research and design. He's a wonderful mentor and the one we go to brainstorm innovative solutions to complex problems and to learn the science of UX. He is an alumni of IDC Mumbai and has worked with companies like HFI and Persistent Systems. Now, to shed more light on this topic, let's go to the questions. Samir, let's start with you. If you could tell us your experience about working remotely on UX for the first time around.
The first time around was pretty much 15, 17 years back.
Okay.
I think most of you guys must have been in school at that time. But that's when we actually practiced and executed remote UX work, including remote testing and remote research, even remote design. Imagine 15, 17 years ago, the maturity of the tools was also less, but we could do that successfully. Huge Designs has been practicing remote UX since its inception. And for a long time, we have also been imparting training to our customers and, you know, other people on how to work remotely. So that's pretty much what I remember about my first experience and subsequent experience.
That's interesting. So if you could add to this, what about your experience?
Yeah. Sami's conversation made it feel like 20 just went by, and our first experience was with, I think this was a Fortune 100 company, banking and finance. Of course, a global company. It had of operations in Singapore, UK, trying to get into India, definitely established very well in the United States. So stakeholders were also globally spread because of the spread across different countries, and hence the users also. And we were tasked to run a end-to-end UX project. So research and design and testing and go back to research if need be. And hence, since it was a global opportunity, we had to make sure that our designers, our researchers were also spread across the world. Primarily, team was definitely in India, and some of us were at a client location. So wonderful experience. You know, languages were different. Time zones, and what I would say, pretty amazing and exhaustive orchestration of research and setting the design direction and establishing all of this remotely. Even the presentation, the final presentation was remote. So I think it was fun, and I would say successful too.
Amazing. So you talked about a lot of variables that go into a remote project, wait time zones, language barriers. So. Mm-hmm. To manage all this, are there any specific qualities that you look for when hiring people for remote work?
Well, nothing specific when it comes to ability to do remotely. What definitely as we do for any of our projects is to have the person be very clear with the basics of UX, right? Because you're saying, hey, UX is our bread and butter, and then whatever comes our way, whether it is remote, in person or whatnot, we should be able to be a good craftsman there. But if I have to ponder a little more in little more deeper, if at all there's a project which needs this whole remote orchestration, I would say this fellow has to be more of a team player. Usually designers tend to be individual contributors, so we'll have to probably watch out for that. Prepare for someone you know, who is doing this for the first or the second time. He should be able to delegate work, right? Because you might have no ticker somewhere, sitting somewhere else, and you are doing research, and the customer is also going to participate in remote sessions. So one should be able to kind of delegate work. Definitely be organized and prepared, right? You don't want to get caught off guard if the connections are not working, if the other person is not understanding you. And imagine if I'm fumbling with my, oh, where is my study guide? Oh, I had to ask this question and that kind of question. So someone who is really organized, well prepared in advance, anticipate challenges and stuff like that, right? Also flair for ability to drive things. Sometimes it does happen that the slightest of unknowns, how do you quickly turn around and still get the show going and the show running? This will come through confidence also, ability to present and field questions, because sometimes users or the clients or even you know, some of your team members may have curious questions and you should be able to field those. So preparedness would help in there also. And I think the last thing, which I also mentioned at the beginning, be prepared with this UX method. If you're good at that, practicing in person, remote is not much of a challenge as far as you take care of these 4-5 things that I mentioned.
Okay, amazing.
What we look for also is a collaborator.
Okay.
You know, person who can collaborate and anchor and be the central person. Because especially when it's remote, everybody has to do more. A little bit more than, you know, what they are used to doing. So if somebody is looking at only, oh, this is my boundary and this is what I'm, my job description and used to be doing, that may not work very effectively and efficiently in remote work. So a collaborator is what we look for, essentially.
That's interesting. Yeah, that kind of summarizes the persona of this fellow probably.
Okay, so that is a good points about what kind of quality should a person have or what kind of a mindset they should have. Now, supposing that we have such a team in place, what are the processes they need to follow to make sure they are able to work successfully in this remote setup?
Process, of course, it's a usual process, because process helps us orchestrate the project well. And you would have the UCD methodology to guide you. Process would mean maybe you have a plan in place of certain activities. Going beyond the process, maybe I'll talk about certain principles that designers and researchers need to keep in mind, especially because of this remote, being on time, starting a session on time like this one, right? You need to start on time, otherwise the participants would be waiting and the customer would be waiting, your colleagues might be waiting, and it kind of represents our brand and it creates an impression of how the next upcoming things are going to be. Keep things ready, as I said in my previous suggestion, is to be always prepared and categorized, you know, be organized. Keep your documents and artifacts ready, because you'll be screen sharing and showing things, so be ready with that. Don't rely only on, oh, there's a conference call. Also keep backup, email, phone calls. They quickly help you to reach out and make things around if certain things may not work. Technology sometimes can be a little more nasty. Or imagine, right, we are talking here and suddenly my voice quality goes down and the screen doesn't paint well, or I'm struggling with, let's say, screen sharing. How would you best help me? I need to be kind of ready for that reach out. So prepare for yourself for that. Also keep promises. When you're orchestrating remotely, there's only one chance that you have, right? You can't go and try things again and again. So keep up the promise of delivering what you have said. I have also noticed when you're working remotely, you need to also delegate. it's okay if he's your product manager or even a client. For example, if you want user participants, you can take the help of the customer to say, hey, you know what, I need these talents to be able to interview them, or I want other group members to attend my design presentation. Can you please help? And you are actually delegating to the client, and that kind of builds nice relationship and energy, I would say. And there have been instances when we had these projects across different oceans. And I would like to kind of see what Samir feels when it comes to, you know, principles and processes, building relationship. What are Samir's thoughts on that one? Because he has always had a big picture across different engagements that we have anchored. And I want to see what would be his suggestion and advice.
See, the principles of design, the principles of empathy, research, data-driven design really remain the same. Mm. The real, I think, important aspect or critical aspect is the collaboration aspect. Mm-hmm. And across different time zones, mm-hmm. across different spaces, because, you know, there may be different time zones and you have to now communicate mm-hmm. to the people the mm-hmm. same thing that you have understood. How do you translate that? So even if you are a great communicator, you know, you need to do much more, mm. right? Sometimes they may be in different time zones, and but on a tool like this, right, it's probably easier to communicate. But when it's completely different, separated by time as well as space, then how do you do that? How do you translate that? How do you get them to, you know, participate in reviews, you know, contribute to the process, and not become an impediment to the progress of the project, mm. right? How do you do that? So those are rather the more important things.
Mm. Interesting the way you kind of said collaborate, but also make it participatory. By what I heard is also cross-validate, because it's always one media, right? I'm talking. I assume the time is done. I'm done with my presentation, but at a regular juncture, cross-validate your understanding, so you're building that collaborative understanding and say, oh yeah, I'm satisfied with these things. Really interesting. Yeah.
Mm. Absolutely. And it has to be like a conversation. It's not a one-way monologue or mm. even a dialogue. Hey, you say things, then I stop, then you say things. That works when it's probably a meeting or two, mm. when it's straightforward, somebody, you're taking opinion. And especially when it's design type work, when it's a lot more collaborative mm-hmm. and requires a lot more exchange of ideas, mm-hmm. then what you say is absolutely true. It's almost like a camaraderie mm-hmm. that you're forming here to be able to deliver effectively, mm-hmm. right? So understanding also each other's strengths and weaknesses. Mm-hmm. Understanding where I can push the boundaries versus you can push the boundary, mm-hmm. and let those things happen mm-hmm. towards mm-hmm. the, you know, larger goal of the project.
Mm-hmm. Mohit, you have been also through this, right? You have had customers who are in the United States, and then someone else from the same team sitting in Bangalore, and also right in the same town that you worked. What was your experience and thoughts there?
So going back to those projects, I recollect that some of the things that you talked about, being prepared, being proactive, these were something that helped me manage those projects. Also about communicating, right? Because we don't see each other face to face, or we rarely meet each other in person, it really helps to build that trust and rapport by making sure the other person knows what is happening. If there's some delay, then we let them know. If there is something we need, we talk to them. So I think communicating, being proactive are the biggest parts of managing a successful UX project remotely.
True, true.
Yeah, I also remember on occasions wherever the, you know, the customer was traveling or you could meet the local touch point, that quickly helped build a rapport for the next all remote events. So that, you know, there's a bit of a gap that can be bridged. Mm. Okay. Sure. Yeah, interesting questions there, Mohit. What else do you have for us?
So what else I would like to know about is, we talked about the principles that people need to have, what kind of qualities they should be having in mind, or the mindset they should have. Mm-hmm. I mean, after all this, which is going on currently, is there something that you'd like to add about how is remote work going to happen in the future?
See, there are certain essentials of remote work. I'll talk about that first. And those essentials, you may call it a secret ingredient, but they are very well known. They are there. It's just a matter of us recognizing them. First and foremost is being proactive, as you rightly said, or the communication aspect of it. You might be a great communicator in person, but in the absence of probably, you know, expressions and being on the same space, you have to communicate more. You have to communicate often. And even the smallest of things, you make sure that you communicate to the right audience, through the right channels, at the right time. So that there is no miscommunication or communication gap. Yeah, I didn't know this, I didn't know that, right? When you are in the same space, there are, you know, non-verbal cues that you get. And it's kind of difficult when you are doing remote work, even through, you know, mechanisms or tools like this. So be inclusive. Wherever you want, you know, help, you kind of ask proactively. And then being disciplined is extremely important when you are remote working, especially working from home, because then too, you kind of tend to be a little bit more casual in terms of your, you know, entire process or getting up late. I would say being disciplined is extremely critical. Behave as if you are at work. You know, get up at the same time. You know, do dress up if you like it. You know, have your separate space. Do take your breaks at the same time as work. You know, do all the same things so that at least that wiring in your brain at work remains the same, right? And then trust has to be there with colleagues. You have to trust your colleagues to do their bit and much more. If you don't have trust, then, you know, there is a lot of micromanaging that may happen, which is very difficult. See, when people work, the biggest thing is not actually the work happening or the skill set or the competency. It's about the emotions of people and how you are managing those emotions. Mm-hmm. Especially when this is, you know, a shock where people are working for, you know, 3 weeks and 8 weeks and 12 weeks from home, quarantined or not in isolation, they might have other people surrounding them. But then it's basically management of emotions. And here's where the trust factor comes in. You know, how do you and how much you trust people? And it's very critical.
Mm.
Now, to answer your question about, you know, what the future looks like. Of course, collaboration tools like these will keep on growing with the new technology advancements in, you know, AR or VR or MR. And that would bring a better context to the entire environment, right? Right now, we work, we go somewhere and we work, we come home and we relax. That's the mental model. You know, that's the wiring of people.
Mm.
And to some extent, you know, the last 20 years, yes, IT people have been working from home time and again, but it's not for a very long period of time. So that chain has to kind of break and say, I can WFA, work from anywhere. Right? Work from home is, you know, just one. You can work from anywhere. Right? And that needs a little bit of different thinking. Mm. The methods and practices of today's design might undergo some kind of change. If continuously you're going to work from home and there are going to be distributed teams and remote work, then are those, you know, brainstorming sessions or whiteboarding sessions, are those really important? And if they are important, how do you kind of make them happen, right? In that environment where 20 people are joining at the same time and everybody wants to talk, how do you kind of use, you know, certain tools? And today there are certain tools like Figma, for example, right, where you can collaborate at the same time and you can draw. So there is an advancement in terms of the tools. There is going to be more asynchronous working. As I said, you know, this, when people are separated by different time zones, you may find that, you know, one great designer is in Australia, but you are in Pacific time. How do you kind of get to collaborate together? And therefore, you will have to kind of communicate, record things, send, so that that person also understands and then contributes. So that asynchronous work is definitely going to grow. ultimately, summing up, I think it's basically about a mindset. Mm-hmm. If one can undergo a mindset change or just orient themselves toward a mindset of taking ownership, being more proactive, of course, being more collaborative, and also committing or doing more than what is required, an infinite mindset, then I think it will work wonders.
Okay. So I like the way you have an optimistic view of the future, where the tools get better, the processes might change, and we are all able to move into new ways of working with each other. And also the part where you talked about empathy and trust, that is something we do in UX. We try to empathize with the user, the stakeholders, and we try to manage their emotions and get them to trust us. I suppose that using those same skills, we can make remote work for us, be it in different time zones or different countries. Prasadd, do you have anything to add to this before we end the session?
Yeah, this is a very interesting thought that Samir brought in terms of asynchronous, right? Someone who's two people who are just not in the time zone and would not be able to probably see and feel for the emotions remotely. Then what's the style with which I should communicate in terms of how do I write? How do I send voice? Because I might be sending voice messages or maybe self-created videos to be able to reach out and show my graphic if I've done some visual, share it, and then you see it when I'm in my bed. How do you narrate what my thoughts are and also wait in anticipation when you send it back? So I think that's going to be important. And then I was also visualizing because eventually our walls probably would be full of videos and each other live and 24/7, probably if not 24/7, at least when I'm working, you could be able to see me and I would be able to see you. I may not talk, but whenever I want to, I just kind of ping you and then, just like Star Wars or something like that, ping a button, give you a message, talk for 2 minutes and go off and continue with my work. You know, those kind of things we should be prepared for. In all those things, how do I switch on and off? Because I need to give you your space also. Mm-hmm. And I need my space also to work. Otherwise, all of us are connected 24/7 also means, you're eating into my space and vice versa. So how do I, when I'm orchestrating work, how do I keep that in mind of giving that space also? Would be very interesting to see how the future unfolds for us in this way. Yeah, those are my thoughts.
And you guys are there. I mean, you will be the future. So maybe you can, reinvent or, create some more methods, processes, tools, and technologies. So you'll get to see much more.
Yeah, good points. I mean, Gen Zs are the ones who may not miss the in-person interaction is what I've heard in a particular report recently, and people they understand that they are seeing someone through a video or a text and or a chat, and they're okay with that. Probably others would need to kind of cope up around with that when different teams of different genres are working together. So very, very interesting times as far as we are on the positive side, and as Samir mentioned, have that kind of a attitude and a spirit, good. Looking forward to that kind of times.
This was an interesting conversation, and I'm definitely excited for the future. So let's see how this goes, and maybe we'll discover new ways of doing things. So for everyone who is listening to us, if you have any questions, anything that you want to add, anything that we could talk about more, you can drop your questions or your comments below. And we'll make sure we have a live session on the same thing again. So stay connected and follow us on our social media accounts. Thank you.
Thanks, Mohit.
Thanks, Mohit. Wonderful.
Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.